Hello and welcome back to Laughing Dragon's Modern 20K main event. It is Saturday, August 12th, and you are Noah Walker.
How you doing, Brad?
How you doing? I'm good. I'm good.
Oh yeah, I'm so happy to, you know, join y'all again. It was really fun to watch that last match. The Dimir control deck with the Minamo untapping the One Ring was really fun for me to personally watch. I hadn't seen the interaction before, so that was a ton of fun for me.
Yeah, I gotta say, I didn't put that together either before it happened. And then Reed noticed it, and I'm like, oh my gosh, that is wild.
Yeah, we're
going into round six, and we've got a feature match set up now. It is Rakdos and Mono Black Midrange. Now, the Rakdos deck is unique. Why don't you talk about that?
Yeah, so I mean, so we've got this mono black midrange deck on the screen. So I guess I'll start with this one. It's really different than most of the decks that you've generally been seeing in Modern. It does have, you know, the if you're playing black package of like you got to include your Thoughtseize, you got to include your Orcish Bowmasters, and then you know it, closer to these Rakdos scam decks that we've been seeing, it has the four copies of Voidwalker and also the four copies of Grief to kind of, you know, round out your early game, get ahead, kind of cheat some spells out occasionally. But also you see four Shieldred. So I think that's a really interesting one because that's Ian saying, you know, I want to play this later game where I'm getting to four mana. I'm just casting my Haymaker spells every turn. And that's the sort of game I want to play.
All right. We'll talk about the Rakdos deck as it pops up here. We've got Ian Friedman on the left, Mono Black Midrange versus Jonathan Martinez on Rakdos. And we're going to get a good look at the hand right away because that's a Thoughtseize from Ian. And take a peek at Terminate. Thoughtseize, and a couple of dual face stand-in cards.
Yeah, my guess is that those are just Fable of the Mirror Breakers. I think that's the only two-sided card in Jonathan's build right now.
It sure is, and they've got cute little drawings on them. I love it.
Which makes a lot of sense, and also that card is like incredibly powerful in a matchup like this. You know, it's just three mana for one card that's going to do a bunch of different things. And I would be surprised, honestly, if Ian didn't take one of them. Because you can't really, you know, choke Jonathan off of anything with this hand, right? He's got two Thoughtseizes, two, I guess, you know, you get rid of the removal spell. I mean, I respect that as well. I am just a little bit worried that Jonathan might be able to run away with the game where he's resolving a lot of these fables. But I also respect that Ian's like, you know, my deck, my focus a lot is to just be resolving this Shieldred on turn four, and Terminate has to be Jonathan's cleanest answer for that. So,
right. Jonathan Martinez is going to spend his first turn firing a Thoughtseize right back at Ian, and these are my favorite matchups because we get to see the hands very clearly. Shieldred the Apocalypse, Shieldred's Edict, the One Ring, and a basic Swamp. And we're going to take the Edict. Both players opting to hit a removal spell with their Thoughtseize.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's just a, you know, concession to the fact that they both think in these matchups, we're going to need creatures to win. So might as well get rid of some of the removal from these hands. Ooh, and a Ragavan off the top. That's a nice one.
Yeah, Dieth Voidwalker for Ian was his second turn play, and a dashed Ragavan for Jonathan Martinez. That is a good play. It's going to connect. There's a trigger with a treasure token and a fetch land revealed.
One thing important about this game to keep in mind is that Jonathan has been losing a lot of life with this place. So far, he's taken two from this Thoughtseize, two from, you know, this Blood Crypt with another Thoughtseize in hand. So you don't want to get too low and just randomly lose this Dieth Voidwalker just because you don't really have a good way to block it.
Yeah, it's a kill it or bust, right?
Yep.
Ian's passed the third turn with just a swamp and an attack. Martinez fires back with Ragavan again, this time revealing Grief.
I think this is just Jonathan being a little bit sad that he's been missing some land drops. I'm a little bit surprised not to see him deploy one of those Fable of the Mirror Breakers on this turn, just because I think it would give him a little bit of a better shot to keep this game churning along, maybe hit some of those lands. So this play is a little bit surprising to me. But I guess, you know, he's like, hey, I'm not even sure that my Fable is going to find me lands, and it's going to cost me my one treasure to make it happen. So,
yeah, it's tough to make those calls when it's not guaranteed, right? Then Ian Friedman attacks again with Dorothy Voidwalker, plays his fourth land, and a copy of the One Ring. Seen a lot of this today. What do you think about it?
Yeah, I mean, I think this card basically single-handedly changed the way that Modern functions. There's a lot of these decks that before, you know, they would have some of whatever their, you know, Haymaker or four-cost card, what have you, in their deck, and those basically all got replaced by copies of the One Ring, just because they facilitate your game plan so well, almost no matter what it is, you know. And they replace themselves with another copy when they're getting too many counters on it and your life total is getting low. They find you so many cards throughout your deck. So, yeah, I think the card is exceptional.
Jonathan's third turn was he lucked into a fetch land, grabbed a swamp, and is deploying Fable of the Mirror Breaker. Now, the Bloodstained Mire is being exiled by Dorothy Voidwalker's static ability. Freeman drops to 13 from the One Ring's upkeep trigger and goes to his main phase with a fifth swamp.
I mean, the One Ring is just going to be so powerful just based on the way that this game is playing out. Jonathan didn't really get low to the ground fast enough to put enough pressure on Ian. So he's just going to be able to spend as much time as he wants to drawing cards now with this One Ring.
Ooh, a Terminate on Shelter of the Apocalypse.
Oh, Malakir Rebirth.
What's that one do?
Wow, that is... it returns a creature, or sorry, let me choose target creature, you lose 2 life. Until end of turn, that creature gains. When this creature dies, return to the battlefield tapped under its owner's control. So it's basically like the feigned death effects that you would see in a lot of these, you know, black-red scam decks. But on the other side, it's also a tapped land. So Ian's saying, you know, I want the ability to sometimes have, you know, turn one, 2 griefs. Other stuff like that. And also it's a black card that you can pitch to grief. And also, you know, I'm casting so many 4-cost cards in my decks, like some games I'm just going to need a land. So I really like the Malakir Rebirth here. I think it's really interesting tech from Ian, and right there it paid off perfectly, you know, kind of saving his Shieldred from a removal spell and being able to gain a bunch of life with his One Ring draws.
Yeah, weird little counterspell in its own way. Dash Dragavan comes back. And the Goblin Shaman token also attacks. That's going to yield 2 treasure tokens for Martinez. And exiling a copy of Sheldred's Edict to the Ragavan trigger.
I mean, not perfect, but everything's going basically as good as they could be for Jonathan here, as long as he has another removal spell. His life total is getting so low that he's not going to have very many options going forward if he... Actually, the shield is just lethal. So he's going to need a blocker or a removal spell or something. And also Ian has access to so many more draws. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, Martinez saw the writing on the wall. He was a little too far behind in mana and other resources that entire game. But this isn't a normal Rakdos Evoke deck, or scam, as the kids call it. This is something else, right? This is... Midrange.
Playing this really interesting Rakdos midrange deck. So it has a lot of the same cards that you would expect to see in you know, the scam deck, what have you. It has the Ragavans, it has the Orcish Bowmasters, the Dothy Voidwalkers, the Furies, the Fables. But he kind of opted, instead of playing, you know, the Feigned Deaths effects, I'm just gonna max out on the One Ring. Like as I said, you know, this Jonathan decided this card is the most powerful thing I could be doing here, like maybe in this entire format. So I'm just going to load up on a bunch of these. I got 2 Blood Moons packed in my main deck. I'm just trying to, you know, really hurt these 4-color decks, these greedier mana bases, and focus much more on just all of my cards individually being really strong.
You think Martinez said, I like the way this mono black deck looks, but I really want to shore up the Tron and the four color decks with Blood Moon. Is that a way that you think he might have approached this format?
You could say something like that. Though I would say that this deck that Ian Freeman's playing is a little bit less popular than, you know, the Rakdos Evoke decks, the Scam decks or whatever. So to me, it looks a little bit more like he took this the typical Rakdos shell and was like, like, I'm not really vibing with the fact that this deck has four Furies and four Griefs and is like a lot of all-in stuff, and kind of decided like, I'm going to, you know, I got my backpack, you know, we got a couple deck boxes in there. I got some black red cards. Like, let me find my favorite ones. No. But it kind of feels like that, you know. It's like a lot of cards that individually are really strong, you know. Shieldred, really good by itself. These Terminates, these Bolts, like, it's just all cards that are good in a plethora of situations, as opposed to like these situational cards that are super duper powerful. So I would guess that it probably mulligans slightly less than these Rakdos Evoke decks that are really trying for their turn one, turn two, extremely powerful plays, and focuses much more on, you know, I am going to play a strong, solid mid-range game, but I could also still, you know, kind of scam you if I get a turn one Ragavan that could connect, you know, maybe get a turn two Blood Moon, like, you never know.
I like that. I like to try to get in people's heads to see why they've made their choices. Most people have made choices, you know, for competitive events like this. They take their time. They learn their deck. They experiment with sideboarding, and they experiment with their last slots. These decks like this that Jonathan Martinez brought, it does look like it was built out of his binder or his backpack, but I'm also really curious, like, what got him there.
Totally. I mean, probably just a preference for a more mid-range style of deck and, you know, really valuing the power of the One Ring in the format. But, yeah, you know, it's... Oh, sorry. Yeah, I was going to say, it's looking like, you know, both of these players at 5-0 with these, you know, not very conventional decks that you'd expect to see. So, I mean, it's clearly paying off.
Yeah, absolutely. Didn't get here by accident. Martinez down a game is going to choose whether to play or the draw. Probably the play. That's a Leyline of the Void in his hand. How good do you think that is in this match?
I am really surprised to see it. Maybe this is like some respect to the Malakir Rebirth that he saw. So, like, obviously, you know, us sitting over here, we kind of have perfect information of exactly what to expect from our opponent's decks. Mm-hmm. And I think that Jonathan in game one was a little taken aback by the Malakir Rebirth on the Shieldred. So he's kind of thinking, like, I don't want to have to deal with any sort of things like that happening to me again. So I'm just going to bring in, you know, a couple of lines, which is a little bit tough. So the way that I would generally expect a matchup like this to play out, you know, the Mono Black midrange versus the Rakdos midrange, is both of the decks expect the game to go later, right? Neither of them have any too many cards that just end the game on the spot, and they both have a lot of removal spells. So the creatures are going to get answered throughout the course of the, you know, beginning of the game. And then it's going to come down to who has more of these potent threats in their deck that they can resolve turn after turn. And I think that, you know, when you put cards like Leyline of the Void in your deck, it's kind of a concession to, you know, these later turns, depending on how many you put in, you know, it certainly has a lot of diminishing returns. Like, you don't want to be drawing these Leyline of the Voids when you're in a top deck war, you know, after you've played a bunch of Thoughtseize, you've gotten griefed, you know, you want only the most potent cards that you possibly draw. So it's a little bit risky, but, you know, so far it's paying off for Jonathan. He brought some in, he had one in his opening hand.
Indeed. We saw a turn one Thoughtseize out of Freedman grab Fury from Martinez's hand. And now it's just a couple of lands staring at each other, followed by...
Looks like a Night's Whisper on turn two.
Whisper. That's the OG art. Yeah,
that's this exact sort of thing that you're going to be wanting to do in this sort of matchup for Ian. Just refilling your hand after, you know, using this Thoughtseize, making sure that you have enough card quality, card advantage over your opponent. It's exactly what you want to be doing.
Indeed. the Knight's Whisper pass back to Martinez. Martinez fetching an end step for a Blood Crypt. Let's see that Fable of the Mirror Breaker. You got one of those?
That is, Jonathan could really use some help this game, just as far as, you know, Ian stripped away a card from his hand with a Thoughtseize, spent turn two refilling his hand with a Knight's Whisper, and all Jonathan's had to do is land, go. So, not looking great for him.
Thoughtseize number two from Friedman. We're looking at the One Ring, Fatal Push, Bloodstained Mire, and Lightning Bolt in Martinez's hand.
So, I mean, if you're Ian, this is a pretty easy take the One Ring. The Lightning Bolt and the Fatal Push, it's like a little bit redundant. You know, there's no way that you can really stop them from killing a possible creature that you play. But the One Ring is the only card in Jonathan's hand that could possibly rebuild him.
Friedman at 13 from Thought Seizes, Fetch Lands, and Whispering. Martinez throws the Bloodstained Mire down and passes right back. Do you think that Castle Lockthwain is going to factor in to the next few turns?
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately for Jonathan, he doesn't have a lot going on. These removal spells, they're not bad. He can do something with them, but it's looking like this Orcish Bowmasters out of Ian is kind of just, you know, pushing Jonathan's hand into, okay, like, I will use one of my spells. You know, I don't really have anything else going on. It's a bit risky for me to just draw a card with this Castle Lockthwain, so I wouldn't be surprised to see a bolt here.
Bolt on Orcish Bowmasters. Trigger still happens. We get an Orcish Army for Friedman. Friedman's a little behind on lands.
Yeah, I'm really surprised to see a Knight's Whisper cast on turn two and then a fourth land drop missed for the Mono Black Midrange deck. But, you know, sometimes the lands just aren't coming.
Well, here's another try at a couple of lands with Knight's Whisper number two. That'll drop Friedman to 10 life. He's going to grab a pair of cards, and I did not see a land in them. Oh, I was wrong. There is one. What is that? That is a Demolition Field or a Field of Ruin?
That's field a good question here.
Okay, I think that's a Field of Ruin.
He's got four Field of Ruin in the deck, so that I'd bet that was a Field of Ruin.
Another Bowmaster.
Yeah, this is a tough one. It's a must answer. Jonathan just drew a land, so I guess he's not too upset to be using a push again. You know, using the cards in his hand isn't too bad, especially considering he wants to use this Castle Lockthwain likely. But the big problem here is he hasn't really put on enough pressure to Ian, and Ian has been, you know, drawing tons of cards and doing a lot with his mana. So Jonathan is going to need to find some cards that actually, you know, affect this board state before Ian takes over the game just on sheer card advantage.
Big turn for Friedman is Sheldred the Apocalypse, and then the Malakir Rebirth was played as the land side for the fifth land. I wonder if Martinez is regretting Fatal Pushing that Bowmasters, but he's not, because he was able to have a second Fatal Push just for Sheldred the Apocalypse.
Another land could be worse, I guess, because now you don't take any damage with the Castle Lockthwain, but that really wasn't what Jonathan was looking for there. He's going to need to be, you know, just really churning out some of the more powerful cards in his deck. Maybe a Fury would be an excellent draw. Shieldred would be an excellent draw. One of the One Rings, you know, he's at least three of those left. Something of that caliber is going to need to show up pretty soon, as we see a Shieldred here.
That was an activation of Lockthwain in response to that Shieldred. Martinez at, I think, 17. Friedman at 10. Martinez is staring down Sheldred with a two-card hand. Low on resources. And definitely in the tank. Let's see what we've got. It's a Touchland and a Lightning Bolt. That won't kill Sheldred.
Those are not too great at killing Sheldred. So just taking a quick peep over here at the deck list, I see two Terminate and two Fatal Push as the main answers for Sheldred, and that is in the entire 75. So a resolved Sheldred is very, very strong here. As we can see, I'm pretty sure one Terminate and already two Fatal Push have been drawn this game for Jonathan. So that just leaves one Terminate as a possible answer for the Shieldred.
Yeah, and given Shieldred's, the way that Shieldred interacts from the One Ring on either side, it puts Friedman in the driver's seat, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, I mean, Jonathan can't even really activate his Castle Lockthwain here because he'll take... Yeah, it will just be lethal. So he's this one draw step and two lethal threats facing down with a land in his hand. So it is looking like it's all but over.
Yeah. Friedman steamrolling Rakdos midrange with his mono black. 2-0. Is that how you saw this matchup going before we started?
I mean... I think the decks are actually really closely constructed as far as, like, you know, it could have gone either way, you know. Both decks, they have these Thoughtseizes, they have these One Rings. Where Ian has these nice Whispers, you know, Jonathan, he had the Fables. I think really what ended up happening was the way that Ian's draws lined up in the matchup were very, very strong, right? He had the turn one Thoughtseize, he had the turn two Night's Whisper. And then Jonathan didn't really get a chance to capitalize, you know, do anything with his mana